The founding story behind like BSOD, how did you and Joel meet and kind of get together and stuff?
We met online, we were beta testing music software together, so we were just kind of, he was throwing clips up there and I was...
Was this when you were in New Orleans or still in LA?
I had just moved to LA, so it was like 98. And yeah, so we met online and we just kind of always joke around online and then finally started collaborating a bit online and then finally met up after that, just made some music together.
So when you and Joel sat down for the first time and like worked as BSOD on the album, what things complemented each other? What aspects of your production and his production really came together to make it?
Well, I guess basically just having different backgrounds. Whenever you can have something that's different than the other person, if you always agree, then it's almost like why even have two people? So it's that common overlap is what you end up achieving, and you sort of hopefully censored each other a little bit. To like, oh, I don't like that. Okay, so if you don't like that, we'll take it out.
Yeah.
So that way, the end result is something that you both agree is good. As for in general, though, I'd say I play a little bit more, so I have a little bit of like chords and kind of the thing. And then he's a little better of a censor, so he's a little more like, I like that, I don't like that, or
yeah.
I can hear how this would be cool. So I play 4 or 5 chords. You take like 3 of them, but switch the order, and then or something like
put
that. And then it's all like, you know, we both think it's cool. It's like. It's something from what I played, but then it's also like, now it sounds cool.
Since you were young, has your production like routine changed at all? I know you like to hear a song and kind of write it down or play it. And
yeah, I still have this, I mean, what's changed I think a little bit is I don't play as much stuff. I used to always like play a part and I'd want to be able to play it until it would quantize perfectly with no fixing your notes. So I'd really like work on my chops, and I've gotten to the point now where I'll just transcribe more and more from what I hear in my head right onto notes on the screen.
Okay.
And not even just bother record enabling and playing it. I've just decided that that's a little quicker of a route. So a few things like that, a little less playing and a little more just like gestures with the mouse.
Do you have any kind of rituals that you do when you're writing a song, or if you hit a mental block, do you have anything that you like to do to kind of kick back and relax and refuel?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm happiest in the position. It's a lot different when you're working on someone else's record and you're like forced to work on the track they want to work on or whatever like that, so you end up hearing the same song over and over all day. And I don't like to do that. I mean, my sort of main thing I do is if I notice I'm listening more than I'm actually changing stuff, this is when I stop. I don't want to like just get overexposed to it too
much.
So I'll try to work quick and kind of put things away and come back to them 6 weeks later or like a long time later and just have it be totally fresh. You can't simply follow all the rules of trying to make something good. You have to just use your own ear. And a lot of people make music, it sounds like it's following all the rules because they're really just trusting their own intuition.
Yeah.
But if you really come from an intellectual point and try to like do it, create music intellectually, it ends up obviously stiff and sounds tired, like something you've heard before. It's not exciting at all. So I don't feel like what... You can definitely get taught the wrong things and get taught into these ways of working that might work for someone else, but not you. So there's a lot of sort of risks you can run with the schooling, but really I think overall it's a good thing, and one of the best things about it is just being with peers. So you're in a room with other people that have similar interests. And when you get out of school and you graduate or whatever, and you're out there in the real world, those are the same people that are going to be out there also trying to make it. So now all of a sudden you have contacts. And some people can't learn from manuals, and they can't learn from just doing it. I'm kind of a click around until I figure out what it's doing when I do this key command kind of guy. And some people are I'll read the whole manual through cover to cover kind of people. And then other people don't even fit either of those categories, and they're really like, I need to watch someone do it.
Yeah.
And that's the only way I'll learn it. So for people like that, school makes a lot of sense. I was never one of those people, really. Like I said, I'm more like the just click around until I figure out how to do it.
What do you also think about like Skrillex now? You know, dubstep kind of glitchy kind of sound is getting huge. What do you think about that?
I think it's great that, you know, that people like Sonny are doing well. I think it's great that there's a lot of kids getting into electronic that may not have been, were it just a house beat type of selection. So there's diversity is good, variety is good. You know, me personally, I'm not interested in digging out dubstep tracks and trying to make a hybrid set like a lot of guys are doing. It's not my thing, but I'm happy it's going on. There's definitely a metal edge to it, a metal element, and in the drumming of a lot of his dubstep and guys with similar sound, it's a lot like it's a lot like a rock drummer. You've got these different patterns that are not just a standard programming pattern, it's much more of a standard drummer pattern. So that's cool. I like that kind of band sound. You know, Sonny's sound he carved sort of a unique sound, which is never easy to do, and whenever I see a guy kind of do that, when you hear their new track and you go, oh, I identify with them.
Yeah.
Anyone who's able to do that is either very lucky or whatever. They have something unique to offer, and so it's great to see those people get recognition for that. So, him, I think he falls into that category where you hear his tracks, like, either that's someone trying to sound like Skrillex or Skrillex.
Yeah.
So, it's easy to always sit back and criticize, and it's easy for people to feel like, oh, he doesn't deserve that success because I could have done that, but you didn't do that. But aside from that, production-wise, I wouldn't say his mixes, they don't sound like all polished and refined, but it's working with him a bit, I came to realize that it's intentional in a sense that it does sound the way that he wants it to sound.
Yeah.
Some guys, he had done a remix for Korn recently, and some other guys got passed off the mix, and he played me his mix and their mix, and he's asked me what I thought, and their mix sounded way more polished and just proper, like a radio mix kind of thing. And he's like, he's just missing something. He plays his mix where it's just more raw and kind of one-dimensional. But sure enough, after you hear that, you're like, yeah, I see why you did it that way. I see why, you know, it's supposed to be that edgy and raw and in your face. And people may hate on it for those qualities, but it's being what it's supposed to be. It's doing what it's supposed to do. So I don't see how you can really, you know, there's always someone there to criticize something. I always wondered where they get the time, because if I was going to sit back and criticize music, I'd be spending all day doing it.
Yeah. Why do you think Joel's music has gotten so big in almost every corner of the globe? Do you think it's more of a branding kind of thing, or do you think that there's something about his production that kind of makes it universal like that?
I think it's definitely the production. Something that really made me feel good is watching his rise to success, because working with someone famous or knowing someone famous is not, because it is what it is, but to watch someone go from obscurity to that, especially when you think that they have a musical talent, is something that makes me feel like he's deserved of it on a merit of talent alone. And of course, haters will always look to the branding, you could say, of it, and say, oh, it's because of the mouse head or whatever. And you can always, of course, never know. But I do think that his music resonates with people on a fundamental level. And it takes a certain type of person to be able to sit in a room and filter ideas out when they don't like things to make a sound that's going to please
everybody.
A wide variety of people.
Yeah.
And it ultimately just comes down to tastes. You know, certain people, what they like in hearing music is what a bunch of people like in hearing music. And then there's some people who could make amazing stuff conceptually or whatever, but their tastes are more avant-garde or like just strange. And so they're never going to hit that level of prominence. So obviously, you need some of that. You can say pop sensibility, but you need some of that hearing a melody that's not too complicated and not trying to over-intellectualize things. If you want to sort of reach a wide audience, that's what you have to do. And so, you know, ultimately, I think people all should just make the music they want to make. It's a personal thing. I do think it's a giving thing, so you do want to make something that's not just self-indulgent, but hopefully other people, you can make something that other people appreciate it. But anytime you step out of your comfort zone and start trying to write a hit song, it's more than likely it's going to fail.
Yeah.
So it's basically just taking one note, right?
Mm-hmm.
Turning it into and a bunch of others.
Yeah, I can hold that chords.
How long do you usually spend on a track in production? Like, I know Wolfgang has always preached the motto that he works like 300 hours on each track, and then
I
interviewed Zed, he said that he hardly, like, he'll do it in a day and stuff like that. And do you think there's a certain timeline that every DJ or producer should follow when making tracks?
No, I think everyone should do something different. They should do however they want to, really. You know, if people are struggling, then maybe they should change their approach, but I think, you know, it's like some guys, if it takes them 2 weeks and they get a great result and they wouldn't have otherwise, then they've made something that's unique for them, so that's great. And then if some guys can bang out something in 4 hours and it sounds finished to their ears, and then that's great. You know, it's a different, you get a different result, and it's a different style of music in a sense. Like, you know, banging something out can make great music. It can survive thousands of listenings potentially. And then on the, you know, the opposite, you can spend 4 weeks on something and just make it worse and worse.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it does chord analysis, which is kind of unique. So it'll, you know, no matter what inversion you play, it'll know that's E minor 7.
Awesome.
And then it can do specific things like only shift the third scale degree or the fifth scale degree or something. So if you want to do like a pattern pitch thing, but not have it shift the whole chord, but just certain notes in the chord. And then you can change inversions and it'll still know you're playing that chord, so it's still shifting that appropriate scale degree. So kind of advanced, maybe too advanced. And I wanna stay.